Well, welcome to the Egan Library. My name's Jonas Lamb. I'm the public services librarian here at UAS. But the best part of my job is this event every year and being the chair of the One Campus, One Book program, which is our common reading program here at UAS. Every year we provide books to all incoming freshmen, and this year we have given out over 200 books to our students, and we start all of them on the same page, and it's a really exciting opportunity to get to feature one of our own tonight. But before I get into introducing tonight's speaker, I've got a few announcements about a couple upcoming events. We have a really special event happening here tomorrow. The UAS Student Club Wu Qin is hosting a UAS and Alaska Indigenous Day community dialogue. So it's gonna be from 12 to 3 here in the library. There will be food, and I'm told it's incredible gourmet food involving a smoked salmon spread and some special peanut butter made with sunflower seeds. Sorry, I'm trying to find Colleen. Okay. Food will be provided, and the Indigenous Day Community Dialogue celebration sort of has come out of, you know, Columbus Day being a federally recognized holiday, which is problematic for many reasons, because of a documented violent history with Indigenous people in the Americas. And UAS students, and fortunately now the state of Alaska, will be recognizing Indigenous Peoples Day on the day that Columbus Day is typically recognized, in the hopes to initiate a conversation on decolonization and healing. So yes, whoop it up. So the student club, they're gonna be reading some anonymous responses that were collected from people in the library, from students on campus, during a week-long period earlier in the month. So that'll be from 12 to 3 tomorrow. And then next Friday night, evening at Egan, we'll feature UAS professor Dr. Sherry Timone. She's gonna be presenting her talk from Alaska to Israel. And she was awarded a Fulbright Scholar Research Award to study crustacean biology in Israel for 4 months. And she'll highlight the important role of the Fulbright program for supporting research, teaching, and cultural exchange. So that'll be next Friday night here. And then I hope to see some of you next Saturday at the New Valley Library from 11 to 2. Ernestine will be offering a community writing workshop called The Art of Memoir. The workshop is open to writers of all levels, and it's free, but we do ask that people register in advance, and there's some information on the back table there for how to register. And then we're also meeting this Wednesday from noon to 1 in Egan 115 to discuss Blonde Indian. We have a little book club going, and we'll be meeting for 2 more Wednesdays, this coming Wednesday, the 11th, and then in December, maybe the 12th, it's on a slide up there, so if you check it out on your way out. And if you have time to linger on your way out, there's a great exhibit called Native Voices, Native People's Concepts of Health and Wellness. It's on loan from the National Library of Medicine through December 13th, so if you haven't had a chance to visit some of the interactive iPad kiosks up there, we hope you'll take some time to do that tonight or next time you're here. And there are books for sale upstairs at the circulation desk. And Ernestine will probably stay afterwards and sign them for you, if you so desire. Ernestine Hayes belongs to the Kagwantan clan of the Eagle Side of the Tlingit Nation. Her first book, Blonde Indian, an Alaska Native Memoir, won the American Book Award, was a finalist for the Penn Nonfiction and the Kiriyama Prize. Last month, Alaska writer laureate Frank Sos announced Blonde Indian as the first selection for Alaska Reads, a statewide reading program. And that will take her all over the state of Alaska this spring. So we're really excited to be celebrating One Campus, One Book and Alaska Reads with Ernestine. Her other published works include Images of America, Juno, and Town Bear, Country Bear. I was gonna try to pronounce that. Sorry, Ernestine, couldn't do it. Her essays have appeared in Studies in American Indian Literature and the Huffington Post. Her poetry is featured at Totem Bight State Park as part of the Alaska's Poems in Place project. She is the recipient of the Honoring Alaska's Indigenous Literature Award, Native American Calling Book of the Month Award, and an Alaska Native Writer Award. She received her BA from the University of Alaska Southeast and her MFA from the University of Alaska Anchorage. And this fall semester, Ernestine's been working very hard, as she always does. She will have visited with more than 200 students in 10 classes, in addition to a Sitka classroom via video conference. And this is also in addition to teaching her normal load. The UAS One Campus, One Book has provided 250 copies of the book to our students here in Juneau and to e-learning students in Metlakatla, Haines, and Whitehorse. In conversations she has with students, Ernestine demonstrates the close connections between students and faculty that are possible here at UAS. Before this event tonight, there was a wonderful reception by UAS honors students in which they gifted Ernestine with some personal and passionate responses to her work. And that's the type of connections that are possible here in Juneau. Thanks to all that were at that reception. Armed with a ceaseless commitment to combating institutional colonialism, empowering the voice of the voiceless, a gentle sense of humor, and a smile, Ernestine is changing the world by changing the way our students consider their surroundings and their part in it. Ernestine also understands the valuable insight that each of her students bring when reading Blonde Indian and sharing their questions. She tells them, writing is a dialogue that is not fulfilled. Maybe it's a transaction? I might be misquoting her. It's a transaction that is not fulfilled until the reader picks up the work. In addition to casting a spell over readers with a unique blend of poetic prose, clan story, and memory, Ernestine has a formula for success that she shares with her students. So be sure to enroll in one of her classes next semester. It's safe to say that many of you have picked up the work and that many more will after hearing tonight's presentation. There's a great potential for a community dialogue in this room today, for each of you to bring your voice into the conversation with the braided voices of Ernestine's magical book. Please join me in welcoming Ernestine Hayes.
Thank you. Thank you, Jonas. Thank you for your kind words, for your wonderful poetry. Thank you for your tireless wrangling of all this through this semester. I really appreciate what you've done to make everything a little bit easier and present my work and Never Alone. That wonderful groundbreaking video to as many people as possible. I appreciate that. Thank you to the attendees tonight, the Evening at Egan series. Thank you, Saul, for the wonderful reception. Thank you to the honors students so much for your moving words. And thanks especially to the Uk Kwan for allowing us to be here on this beautiful land. Before I begin, let me say that it is not my intention for my words to offend anyone. I don't believe that they will. But if they do, it's not my intention, and please forgive me. One of my first jobs after I came back home to Juneau was at a native theater where we told old songs and sang and drummed old stories. At the end of each performance, we stood in a line on the stage and introduced ourselves in our native language and then translated what we had just said. I would say, Tlingit k'inach sanga tlacht yuchat duasak. My Tlingit name is sanga tlacht. Tlaitka k'inach Ernestine Hayes yuchat duasak. My white man name is Ernestine Hayes. Chak na ayahat, I am eagle. Kogwantanayahat, I am of the Burnt House People Clan. Guchit ayahat, I belong to the Wolf House. Gunachtedi dachang hatsati, I'm a grandchild of the Gunachtedi. Yanwasha, I am a Kogwantan woman. Sitka Kwan, my clan springs from Sitka. The woman standing next to me would step forward and say, Tlingit enach ka steen yuchat duasakwa chukane diayachat. I am of the people from the grassy place, and I belong to Glacier Bay. And I love to hear her say that, for it describes our relationship to the land. Who our land now belongs to, or if land can even be owned, is a question for politicians and philosophers, but we belong to the land. There is not one Tlingit person, from the most modern corporate executive to the most unsophisticated villager, from the oldest great-grandparent whose dim eyes can see only memories, to the youngest child who has just learned to form the words, who will not say, this is our land, for we still belong to it. We belong to Tlingit Ani. We can't help but place our love there. I'm afraid I caused a bit of confusion when I was working with Jonas to develop a title and description for my talk tonight. The phrase an animate world might be interchangeable with an animated world. Animate, possessing life. Animated, full of life. Everything is alive. Everything possesses life and is full of life, full of spirit, full of energy. A life-possessing world. Remember that the land is inspirited. It is quickened. When, as you conduct your life, you chance to see an eagle, or a wolf, or a bear, remember that it, too, is conducting its life, and it sees you as well, as does a tree and the forest itself. The very land sees you. When you remember this and feel this and know this, you will want to hug the land. You will want to embrace it. And when that happens, you can be sure that the land feels the same way about you. The land loves you. She misses her children. While I appreciate the opportunity to read the introduction and the conclusion from my book, I must say that it is with the writing between the beginning and the end that we concern ourselves today, an animate world. The beautiful posters designed by artist Allison Krein are a joy to see. One of them I especially enjoy, and that is the one that says, everything sings, I am part of the song. I am part of a world that sings, a life-possessing world where we are all part of a song. Before I begin, I need to remind you of two important points that I try always to declare whenever I find myself in a room with what appears to be a captive audience. I'm sure that many of you have heard these two truths before, perhaps a number of times, but I don't apologize. Some things need to be said more than one time. Some things need to be heard over and over. Thank you. Please indulge me for a few moments. Before we pause for this allotted time to consider our living world, it behooves us to take a quick look at the history of this place and interrogate the foundational assumptions upon which the systems that shape our understanding of success, failure, and values are constructed. First, almost every source describes the long record of Native use and occupation that took place before European contact as prehistory. Indigenous groups, however, possess a history of thousands of years of occupancy and exodus, relocation and settlement, exploration and discovery, embedded throughout the generations in legal process, artistic declarations, symbolic regalia, and oral tradition, at least as accurately and in many cases more accurately than the European system of writing that was used for many years after contact to remove rights and appropriate lands. We must always remember that before contact, Native cultures possessed vigorous legal systems, effective educational systems, efficient health systems, elaborate social orders, sophisticated kinship systems, complex languages, profitable trade systems, every social institution needed for a culture to flourish for thousands of years. Second, we do well to remind ourselves that had the colonial invasion not taken place, Alaska Native people would still be living in the 21st century. Our lives would still be modern. Paved roads, airports, and electricity would still occur here in Tlingit Ani. Some things would be different, of course. We would be speaking our own language. We would be living in houses of our own design. We would be not so vulnerable to incarceration, alcoholism, poverty. Our children would be healthy. I gave a talk 3 years ago that iterated these concepts, which were summarized in the local newspaper, and the online comments were not unexpected. The sophistication of indigenous thought, the effectiveness of indigenous social systems, that indigenous people had social systems at all, are not part of the song the people of this colonial culture are commonly taught. Many of the comments on the paper's website were, shall I say, harsh. It appears that a great many people, at least those who were then inclined to post anonymous comments, believed that had it not been for colonial invasion of Tlingit Ani, the indigenous people would not now be living in the 21st century at all. Not having invented light bulbs or airplanes, the common refrain went, we would be without such modern contraptions. Still doing without such things as fireworks and avocados. All the things the colonizers brought to us. That was the colonial song. What did the colonizers bring that the original people did not already possess? An education system, many said. That indigenous people already had an effective education system that for thousands of years had produced knowledgeable, successful members of a vibrant society was not part of the song they were singing. Colonization brought you education, they sang. Learn someone else's history. Learn someone else's way of thinking. Learn someone else's values and categories. Be punished for speaking your own language and for not thinking the way you're told to think. Assimilate. Drop out. My mother had an 8th grade education. I dropped out in 10th grade. What did the colonizers bring that the original people did not already possess. A health system, many of the commenters said. That indigenous people already had an effective health system that for thousands of years had produced strong, long-lived members of a vibrant society was not part of their song. Colonization brought you a health system, they sang. My mother and an uncle had tuberculosis. My aunt had diabetes. I had rheumatic fever. Several people in my family suffered from and died from alcoholism, suicide attempts, substance abuse, unhealthy diet, poverty. The colonizers brought a health system, but they did not bring us health. Values, many of the commenters said. That indigenous people already had a complex, successful belief system founded on an understanding of our balanced world and that recognized and respected a life-possessing world was not part of their song. Colonization brought you values, they sang. Colonization brought you our language. Colonization brought you our history. Colonization brought you our laws, our institutions, our philosophy, our religion, our society. Colonization brought you our song. An animate world, a life-filled world, a world where everything has spirit, everything has energy, everything has life. It was already after the day that Raven dropped the land from his mouth. That was long before. It was also after the day that Raven spit out the rivers and streams onto the land. That too was long before. And it was well after the day that Raven brought daylight into the world. It was the midnight of the long ago day when the glaciers began to retreat. It takes a measured while to do such a thing. The glacier's retreat this time was not as rapid as had been their advance. When the glaciers decided to advance, they did so in a rush. Often they ran chasing things, but when the time was full, when after how long they had pushed so close to the sea, but didn't make it all the way, they'd pushed so close, but always there had been that edge of land, some plants, some trees, a few caves, always a stretch of beach. They couldn't quite cover it all. After pushing as hard as they could for as long as they could, finally they gave up. They stopped pushing. They rested, just a short while for a glacier, only a little while in Raven time, and began to back up. Slowly in most cases, bit by bit. At that midnight, when the night turned over in its sleep, the edge of the now never covered land was almost bare. Part of the land sticking out from under the lips of glaciers here and there were crusted black with cold. Only tufts of moss grew on alpine-like land near the lengths of unruly beaches. But not far from those long beaches, the intertidal community was rich. Farther out, the deep ocean made an abundant home for the rich plankton that bloomed each annual cycle in a swimming curtain thick enough to call herring and crab and whales from their farthest winter homes. The low sea level made of the beaches long, dank expanses of living and dying and dead muck and slime and drifted wood and seeds from the warmer shores. The glaciers waited, planning capitulation. Shorebirds' bellies flew heavily to the beach where their digestion dropped onto the newly exposed ground, the seeds and nutrition from past and recent feasts. At the right time, the birds built rough nests on the rocks and on the beach. and the females squatted to deposit their eggs onto the hard ground and warm them with soft bellies. The birds didn't use their nests for long. They stayed on those eggs for little more than a cycle of the moon, but that was long enough to notice that the ice was already farther away than when they'd first come to this place. By the time the eggs began to make croaking noises from inside, and then pecking noises, and then to display little cracks, and then bigger cracks, and then a whole baby bird's beak and eyes and head, and finally a wet, scrawny bird child, the ice was even farther away. By the end of the first summer season, after that long ago day when the glaciers decided to retreat, the edge of the ice had almost reached the island's inside coast. For the space of one winter, and then into spring, and then to summer, that ice rested in a cold, wet land, and against its own will, it advanced a little space, and with the next warming season continued its retreat. The uncovered land appeared meager, but held within it all the life, all the promise, all the seeds of our own future yet unborn. These things I speak of are not strictly an indigenous way of seeing the world, of understanding our world. This is not only an indigenous song, this is a human song. These values, this connection, this awareness, this knowledge, this way of seeing the world, these are the human ways of knowing. Everything is connected. Everything has energy. Everything has spirit. Everything is alive. Everything sings. I am part of this song, but what song are we singing? If you had to design a racist colonial state, what would it look like? The life expectancy of the indigenous population would be measurably lower than that of the dominant group. In a colonial state, poverty rates for the indigenous population would be far greater than for the dominant group. In a racist state, incarceration rates for people of color would be significantly higher than for the dominant group. In a culture built on colonialism and racism, violence, substance abuse, homelessness, and other aspects of cultural trauma would be common. In a culture built on colonialism and racism, suicide rates would understandably, predictably, inevitably be greater for members of the oppressed groups than for members of the dominant group. When your children went to school, there would be few, if any, indigenous teachers. Few teachers of color. When you received medical care, there would be few, if any, indigenous physicians or physicians of color. And this would be the case almost everywhere you went, in almost every institution. This is the song that now surrounds us. Is this the song you sing? But what has colonization to do with our lives today, the chorus might sing. Dakota scholar Scott DeMuth warns that it doesn't mean that progress has been made in the relationship between colonized and colonizers just because we do not observe open repression on a daily basis. At its core, he says, colonization is still serving the same purpose it always has. Resisting colonialism is not a way to attack the system. Resisting colonialism is a way to defend ourselves from the system. Indigenous leader Michael Yellowbird reminds us that we undergo the constant stresses of colonialism and we experience the effects of colonialism every day. An attempt to deal with that stress, he says, does not alter the colonial relationship we endure. We can, though, take steps that make us stronger and that prepare us to challenge colonialism forcefully and effectively. How shall we do that? Scholars agree that the first step towards decolonization is to question its legitimacy. Such an act cannot be passive, but requires reflection that leads to action. We have come to midnight of the colonial day, and the shroud that has covered this land has begun to retreat. It may take a measured while to do such a thing. The retreat may not be as rapid as its advance. After the 1867 transaction, after the presence of gold was revealed, and fish, timber, tourism, oil, the advance was headlong and unstoppable. But now the time is full. How long the colonial weight pushed so close to the depths? So close, but always there has been that edge of unconquered spirit. Some songs, some stories, some knowledge, a few remembered sayings, always the people who came before us. So the colonial weight could not quite cover it all. And after pushing as hard as they could for as long as they could, finally the colonizers will stop pushing so hard. Finally they will rest just a bit. Finally they will change direction, slowly at first, bit by bit. At that midnight, the night will turn over in its sleep. The edge of the never-covered spirit may seem almost bare. Parts of the life here and there are crusted from the pressure. Parts of the life here and there seem barren and cold. But not far from those cold places, the currents are rich. Not far from those cold places, life grows. Every time we raise our voices, every time we change our song, every time we stand for equity, that colonial weight is further away. The uncovered life no longer appears meager. That growing uncovered spirit holds within it all the life, all the promise, all the seeds of all our futures. But what is decolonization? The chorus will sing. In her landmark book, Decolonizing Methodologies, Linda Tuhiwai Smith says, decolonization, once viewed as the formal process of handing over the instruments of government, is now recognized as a long-term process involving the bureaucratic, cultural, linguistic, and psychological divesting of colonial power. The divesting of bureaucratic power, red tape, selective enforcement, self-serving regulations, grand juries, internal investigations, policies and procedures that examine themselves and declare themselves without blame, bureaucratic power. The divesting of cultural power, holidays, standards, norms, marginalization, defining values, defining virtues, defining beauty, defining intelligence, defining authority, defining worth, cultural power. The divesting of linguistic power, language, the power to force others to speak your language, the power to disregard and even prohibit other languages, linguistic power. Linguistic power also means the English language, the form of language, the meaning of language, the context of language, the privileging of the English language and its proper form above all others, the power to determine meaning, the privilege to organize context, the authority to exalt one's own words, linguistic power. The divesting of psychological power, the power to affect or cause something to arise in the mind, the power to affect the mental or emotional state of others, the power to make people think that all this is okay. The power to make people believe that dropout rates, incarceration, suicides, people living in poverty, people being gunned down in the streets is acceptable. Psychological power. Decolonization, divesting colonial power. Some scholars go further and call for indigenization. Some universities have made a commitment to indigenize the academy. The University of Regina, located in Saskatchewan and serving some 12,000 students, has made that commitment and defines indigenization as the transformation of the existing academy by including indigenous knowledges, voices, critiques, scholars, students, and materials, as well as the establishment of physical and epistemic spaces that facilitate the ethical stewardship of a plurality of indigenous knowledges and practices so thoroughly as to constitute an essential element of the university. It is not limited to indigenous people, but encompasses all students and faculty for the benefit of our academic integrity and our social viability. More and more universities and other institutions, including our own, are calling for decolonization and indigenization. I hear a new song. For generations, indigenous people have stood at the brink. In the past few years, a strong call has risen, a call to turn away from that brink. I hear a new song. Sunset came a long time after the glaciers first decided they would go all the way back to the mountains where the night is long, even though the sun was beginning to set, the place where the glaciers had been was still in bloom. Imagine a land once covered with glaciers, now covered with bloom. Imagine the breeze at the end of the day, soothing the dancing blossoms, teasing them because it loves them. Imagine their colors, blue and purple, tinged with white and green, slowly fading with the evening light, slowly fading with the autumn cold, quickly releasing all their seeds onto the waiting earth, who receives and embraces and nurtures this next generation. The seeds will wait. Not much allows itself to be seen in the cold, white, snow-covered daylight. Not much movement, not much life. The glacier is still. It bides its own time and keeps its own secrets. The ocean moves as it always has. On the other side of the water, mountains fall behind mountains, and island falls behind island. The winter daylight is bright, but all the colors beneath the clouded sky are shadowed in gray and dark green. The sky on this day is cockleshell gray. The beach is overcast brown. The winter's ocean waves are mystery blue. The lowest edges of clouds are summer dirt white. They match the tops of the mountains, which urge themselves to reach and touch and become a part of the sky. Here or there, the suggestion of yellow or red reveals a dried secret blossom or berry. In every other place, under the snow, it is green. Green is the color of the froth that floats on the waves and deposits itself on the intertide to dry and crack and frame the print of the trail of the gull or a raven searching for food. Moss growing on the beachside rock peeks out of the fracture where it broke the basalt a raven's day ago, flushing the cheek of the petroglyph's face to a bashful green. An eagle lands on a cedar snag. The highest branches submit. The eagle looks down on the canopy and for a moment sees nothing but green. In the field near the beach, clover will bloom. In the clearing not far from the muskeg, Hudson Bay tea. These and other plants will sustain a good life. In the dim shadows, skunk cabbage will hide. The bear and other creatures will find it delicious. They will prepare their greens in this way. They will bite off and chew. Inside the forest, it will never be bright. Rays of sunlight will define uncovered ferns. Jacob berries will modestly reveal themselves on the forest floor. Devil's club and bushes of every kind will push toward the nearest creek. Here and there will be sunlight, berries, fresh water, a path. Underneath the snow, all will be green. We live in a world where people of color are incarcerated at far higher rates, endure poverty at far higher rates, are denied health care and employment at far higher rates, drop out of school at far higher rates, suffer depression, intergenerational trauma, loss of history, loss of family, loss of homes, loss of health, loss of life. We are living in a world built on colonialism, oppression, racism, genocide, and slavery. This is the song that has filled the air everywhere we go, and those of us who have been silent have been part of that song. How has this affected your life? Remembering that silence is part of the song, what is the song that you are singing? Remembering that decolonization is not passive, what are you willing to do? Do everything you can to right even a small wrong, for small wrongs support and strengthen a system of oppression. Speak up every time something needs to be said that no one else will say. Stand up for equity. Stand up for right. When you see a wrong, do everything you can to bend it toward justice. When you see someone whose voice has been taken away, speak out on that person's behalf. When you witness unfair treatment or unprincipled behavior, stand up, make change, raise your voice, sing this new song. Most of you who are here tonight have already taken action and have already raised your voices. If you have been hesitant to take action, I call on you now. If you have been silent, I urge you to raise your voice. I challenge you now to join us here at the brink Let us all resolve to sing a new song. Let us resolve that we will bend our thoughts toward justice. Let us determine to work for a balance of power. Equity is our goal. Let us resolve to stand here together at the brink. Together at the brink of our shared history, where everything sings and everything is alive. Thank you. Thank you. I know that I'm preaching to the choir, but it's still a song.
And wow, we have a hot microphone for your questions. So if you have a question, if you could just put your hand up, I'll bring you a microphone. And that way we can get your question recorded for the people watching at home.
Okay then. That was good.
We have a question.
Gunesh Cheesh. I love the power behind a new song. What inspired you to use that thought, a new song?
Thank you. I believe that when I wrote about that song at the very at first, it was when I was in California and I stopped at alongside a creek and I saw everything moving, and I realized that there was a song going on in the world. And as I began to think further, especially recently, I've realized that not everyone is singing our song. I hear it and I read it, and I know that there are sincere beliefs of other ways. So when Jonas asked me to speak here tonight, I thought this would be my opportunity to make a call to everyone to change the song that we're singing.
Gunesh Cheesh, Anelkoa, Ah, Octuok, like a Yakuk dark, Ishkat Nike, Wuku, Ah, Ya Kunakik Eowa, Hashilko has us to Skat Nikso, Ah, Kindi Hasha, Yik Octatani, Wuk. The words that you've created in this book, and a lot of the things that you have done and things that you still do for our community as a whole on bringing equity and the voices that you have for the students, trying to make sure that all students' points of view are always balanced. I wanted to say, Atlin Gunesh Cheesh, your story is much like many of our ancestors before. And for us to be able to look at this year and see that your words are being shared amongst today's generation. It's humbling and also exciting because we know that's a voice that can never be silenced. And it'll be forever out there. Which is why I said "Atlanguinchish." Thank you very much. Much like Nora and Richard. And what Ishmael was doing the other night with the game. You are also helping by putting in a post that we can look forward to and building a house that is strong enough for all of us to be able to withstand any kind of storm that comes our direction. And the words that you have for us within these stories, within your past, within your present, will always stick with us. Thank you very much.
Don't be shy. Okay.
Good evening. I'm John Devraj. I'm from India. I'm very pleased to be here to listen to your song. You sang it very well.
Thank you.
I am a part of the indigenous Indians of India, doubly colonized by the British and also by the Aryan supremacy. I'm a Dravidian, the original indigenous people of India. So, and what you are saying is very parallel to what has happened in India, but only multiplied a million times.
Yeah.
There are 1,300 million people in India. So, and I'm also reminded of the teachings of Dr. Ambedkar. Your words, every bit of what you're saying is very parallel to Dr. Ambedkar, who was a champion of Dalit rights. And those indigenous people, we call them Dalits, those who are socially, politically, and culturally oppressed. And we call them Dalits. And it is a very piquant situation in India because much before the British came, the Aryans were actually oppressing us. So we got doubly oppressed by two groups, the Aryans and the British. And I want to ask you with all this, how is it possible to reverse it? We can't wish it away. The reality is far more. Majority of the people in India are indigenous people. And I also work with these people, and I work with the street children, 130 million of them, all of them are indigenous children who are on the streets and who are working. So how could we bring about this change? How could we reverse this? How could we empower them? And this is my question to you.
No. I should have studied more. There's a quote, and I'm afraid I didn't. I told myself I should look it up in case I needed to say it, and then I didn't. But I believe it's by a European man named Max Planck, I think, that says something to the effect that you don't have to change a population, you change the way people believe. You only have to raise the next generation to believe it. So that says two things to me. And the first is, I almost never try to reason someone out of an unreasonable position. And I feel that oppression and colonialism are not only unfair and unjust, it's unreasonable. So I don't try to reason someone out of that system. So that's one thing that quotation tells me. But the other thing is that we are raising this next generation. We have professors here who understand what needs to be done and what needs to be passed on to the next generation. The leaders are here among us. Tomorrow's thinkers tomorrow's leaders, tomorrow's decision makers are the ones who are going to make that difference and make that change. We're planting that seed, they are the seeds, and they're going to grow and they're going to change this world because they're already singing a new song, and I think that's our hope.
Maybe we'll open it up for a couple more questions.
Excuse me. I would like to refer back to your comments about universities in terms of indigenizing and decolonization. And I want to share an experience that my husband and I had this summer. We were in Billings, Montana. Oh, Bozeman, thank you, in Bozeman. And we went to visit the university that our godchild had gone to. And I was so impressed as I walked around the campus and I saw a building that was devoted to Native American students. And then we were buying a camper to put on our pickup truck. And the person who was selling the camper had a teaching credential. And I had gone to UAS and had gotten my elementary ed credential here. And so I was visiting with him, telling him I was from Alaska, that I was Alaska Native, and he was very fascinated because to get his teaching credential in Montana, he shared with me that he had to take several credits in Native American culture and history. And I thought to him, I said to him, well, that's really interesting because I come from a state where one-fifth of our population, if you count the descendants of Alaska Natives, are indeed Alaska Native. And yet, for my credential in elementary ed in the state of Alaska, my exposure and only requirement was multicultural education and Alaska history course. And I really valued my UAS experience, and I'm not knocking it, but I walked away thinking, how interesting in Montana. And this gentleman was like me, he had gray hair. And so he had done his teaching, his accreditation earlier in his life. So that spoke to me about the fact that in Montana, the universities value their teachers having several credits in learning Native American culture and history. So maybe we can step up here in Alaska and push ourselves to require more of our teachers so that our children, when they go to school, have empathy and they see their culture reflected in their curriculum. Thank you.
Thank you.
First of all, I want to say that since I started here 3 years ago, how incredibly proud I am, fortunate I feel to have come to a university that is indigenized, as I believe you put it. But my question real quick would be, how did you settle on the metaphor of the song as opposed to, say, story or some other form of communication?
Well, the song itself, trope has been with me for a little while, a few weeks. But as it happened, the metaphor of the glacier just came to me today, and I had chosen that passage to read. And then as I was reading it in the context of the other comments in my talk, it became so obvious that this is a metaphor for our experience, that colonialism is the ice that covered the land, but there was always that refugia, that strip of life that never was covered, and now the glacier is retreating, and the life is springing up that was always there. So it's not so much that I settle or think of these things, it's just more that they reveal themselves. And they don't just reveal themselves to me, I know, they're there. And they reveal them, they're there to be revealed to everyone. And it says decolonization is reflection that leads to action. And that reflection tells us these truths. I believe very strongly that if we study and contemplate nature, the things that happen in nature, any element of nature, then we will learn about ourselves.
Yep. Okay. One more question? Any last questions? Okay.
I am very fortunate to have had a student at the university this fall who brought home a copy of your novel, and I read it within the last month and was very moved. It's a very, very powerful book. I'm curious, what are you working on now? What can we look forward to reading from you in the future, Ernestine?
Nice question. As it happens, I just got a contract about 2 weeks ago from the University of Washington Press for my next book, which is scheduled for publication in fall 2016. It's being peer-reviewed now by Linda Hogan, and it is, I consider it my sophomore book, and it is a sequel to Blonde Indian, and it is called, the working title is The Tao of Raven, an Alaska Native Memoir. And that's coming out next next fall. And I love it.
Thanks everybody for coming out this evening. I believe Ernestine looks like she's ready to sign some books or to chat with you at the table back here by our bear skeleton. I want to thank Ernestine for being a very necessary voice on this campus, in this community, and in this world.
Thank you, Jonas.
And for that wonderful call to action.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night.